Thank you. Clara Johnson.
I think you should be at peace because I, you know, if you're going to be insulted, threatened, and intimidated, you should have your constituents do it. I'm trying to make you laugh. I admire the spirit and the dedication of all the people who come from other communities because they're working for something that they really believe in. And what they don't evidently realize is that we believe in trying to treat people fairly as well, but we would like to exist as we have existed, our character of our community. And you're going to build Parkside, which they may not know about, which does fulfill, I think, our fair share of the Bay Area's housing. You're going to have around 300 units there or close to it, and you're still looking for more projects. That will, I think, be something that makes sense for the community and also helps the region. So, thank you. My prepared remarks, I have given them to Ingrid. And I wanted to tell you that I watched your July 26 meeting yesterday and read the staff report today, and I appreciate the numerous questions that you ask. I have some comments and some questions, and I've organized them by subject because all that numbering that was repetitive was driving me crazy. Regulators and remediation. BCDC has jurisdiction over portions of the Baylands. The city should make contact with them and let them know where we are in the process and ask them for their comments, because you asked that question somewhere and someone told you they hadn't talked to them in a long time. Well, why don't you have the staff give them a call, you know, so you know the current, what they're thinking and what you're thinking. Because to me, for somebody to say, well, 18 months ago I knew what they wanted, well, check it out now to find out, so, and tell them where we are. There are more than 80,000 known chemicals, and only a few hundred of them have been evaluated for their impact on human health. There are more chemicals on the Bayland than those listed in the monitoring report, and the actual health risk is greater than is acknowledged. The problem is that the regulation of toxic chemicals is sadly inadequate, and we can't change that at the moment, but I think we should all work to have it improved so there's a better understanding of what the risk is. The discussions you have had about the tremendous amount of soil placed on the site don't ever include the fact that that soil is required to separate the public from the contamination. And it must be approved by DTSC, Regional Water Quality Control Board, or as the staff report mentioned, Cal Recycle. The soil for OU1 and OU2 needs to be of a type and soil pore size that is appropriate to act as a barrier. And the soil they brought in is all, they don't know that. You know, they haven't done it that way. They've just been giving us fees and piling thousands of cubic yards on there, which they may have to remove in order to put the proper soil there. I think it's much more of a mess, I think, than they acknowledge to the city, because they have not made a deal yet, as I understand it, with DTSC at least, about that. It's not resolved, and they have to satisfy the regulators. So I think that should be mentioned when you're talking, because we're talking about moving the soil as though there was no one else involved, and there definitely is. Also, before 2010, the soil was not adequately tested, and they've been ordered to test it all in lots of something like 1,000 cubic yards. There are plans that UPC has agreed to make sure that the regulator standards for that are met. I don't know the Cal Recycle requirements, but I think it would be similar. Recreational infrastructure, this is a question someone asked. All infrastructure is supposed to be paid for by the developer. Playing fields are infrastructure, so they should be their recreation infrastructure. They should be paid for by them. In an earlier Baylands presentation, Ms. Dangemon of Dangemon Landscape Architectural Firm said that she found a study indicated that there has been interaction between chemicals used to treat turf and the chemicals that were part of the contamination of the soil underlying that turf. So this issue should be investigated before you place playing fields anywhere on the Baylands. As long as you can get some information, make sure you're not creating a problem. Golden State Lumber, since the staff hasn't spoken to them in 18 months, it would be wise if they touch base with Golden State Lumber. They can tell you what they're thinking. You can tell them where the project is. Water supply. During the EIR process, you use an attorney who specializes in water issues. Why not bring her back to review the current circumstances? She might provide more information regarding the probability of water being available for the project. The agreement to make an agreement for the OID water doesn't mean much unless there are agreements with MID and SFPUC, who have both said that there isn't enough information in the AR to know whether they could accommodate our needs or not. If all the water available to use is pledged to others, then we're out of luck. It seems like an unreliable source of water. The pressure on water resources is increasing with population. The past is not a good predictor of future availability. Landfill. According to Dr. Lee, long-term post-closure municipal landfill failures after 20 years or more occur fairly frequently, leaving the host municipality to pay for repairs. We must be certain to protect against this possibility. Traffic, parking, greenhouse gas emissions, and transit. Where is the evidence that reducing parking well below the expected needs for developments actually reduced car usage and greenhouse gas emissions, and by how much? The report just lists cities that have done this. A former planning director told me once that it was kind of wishful thinking, that if you start looking at usage, car usage, people driving alone, those figures don't change that much. So if you're going to just, you take away the parking, make neighborhoods absolutely impossible to park, then you ought to be sure that there's actually going to be a payoff. And I think there may be information available that could tell you that, you know, that how many trips or they've taken a certain area. You could try to find it. The table on page 13 of your staff report indicates that after the project, the LOS will be 50 seconds at some and more than 50 seconds or 80 seconds at other intersections. Any number above 80 seconds, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 12 minutes, is not a very helpful table. Noise, item number 26, the noise metric should be expressed in dBA to link it to human hearing, and perhaps a CNEL number should be given so you'd have an idea of the impact of the sound over the course of a day. The liability for this project should be assigned to the developer in any and all agreements signed by the city. It's not only sea level rise, but also chronic inundation that's a problem with sea level rise. The Union of Concerned Scientists has published a report on areas that will be inundated by flooding caused by sea level rise. And we should ask for a detailed copy of that report, because it's difficult to read the map that the public can get on the internet. And I think we find that helpful. The San Mateo level report, the San Mateo sea level rise report, is very conservative. It says 6.6 feet is the outside high number, not according to everyone else. That's an old figure. I'm almost done. And you can decide not to approve any project because you have an inadequate EIR. The renewable energy alternative without so much commercial space looks good for the town and the environment. Excuse me. Toxics must be monitored, and if they start to move, the owner has to do something about it, no matter what you do. They can't just sit there and let them start moving, because that's when the regulators will move. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Claire. Victoria.